Absolutely. Well, thank you, Stephanie, and a special thank you to all the staff that have helped us to make joining us. While it's a shame that we can't be together in person, it's a great opportunity for us to engage with alumni across the spectrum, wherever you might be joining us today, to really focus on that legacy of learning, which is, of course, part of the core fundamental of what it means to be a Norwich alumni. I'm really excited to talk about information wars today. And like I said, on behalf of the entire Norwich University Alumni Association Board of Directors, really pleased to have with us Professor Travis Morris, who joined the faculty of Norwich University in 2011. He is a CJA professor at the School of Justice Studies and Sociology. He also directs Norwich University's Peace and War Center. He has a bachelor's in criminology from Northern Illinois University, a master's in criminal justice from Eastern Kentucky, and a PhD from the University of Nebraska. He's published on the relationship between policy, peacekeeping, counterterrorism, and counterinsurgency. He's also the author of a recent book, Dark Ideas: How Violent Jihad and Neo-Nazi Ideologies Have Shaped Modern Terrorism. He's conducted many interviews in Yemen and published on his own How Crime Intersects with Formal and Informal Justice Systems. His research interests include violent extremists, propaganda analysis, information warfare, and text-to-network analysis. He is, of course, an active teacher, both inside the classroom and out. We are thrilled to have him with us today. So again, Professor Morris, thank you for being here and putting together this wonderful panel to talk about information wars.
Hey, thank you, Joe. And we'd just like to say hello to everyone that's listening to us, wherever you are in the globe. Glad you can join us. And I'll introduce our panelists later on, but would like to thank you in advance for being here. So today's topic, extremely relevant. And before we get into some framing, I'd just like to cover a couple of administrative notes. So should you have any questions along the way, you should be able to look to your go to webinar panel. There should be a question. You can type a question in there. You can direct it to Stephanie Snell. And at the end of the session, she will sort and field some of the questions. We won't be able to get to all of them, but if you do have questions along the way, please use that feature. I'd be glad for our panel to address some of your questions. So let's just go ahead and begin. So on February the 15th, 2020, the Director General of the World Health Organization, he was addressing the Munich Security Conference. And at that moment, back in February, there were 66 cases of COVID-19 in China, only 505 in the world. He was concerned about the lack of the urgency of the international community and the severe disruption of the market of personal protective equipment and health workers at risk. And he was concerned about the havoc that this would cause in countries across the globe. But there's a part of his speech, and this is why we're here today, that he directly addressed the audience, and this is what our panel is about today, and I quote, "We're not just fighting an epidemic, we're fighting an infodemic. Fake news spreads faster and more easily than this virus and is just as dangerous. And if we don't tackle this, we're headed down a dark path that leads nowhere but division and harmony." That was back in February 2020. Before we go any further, you're going to hear some terminology and just want to specify a little bit of definitional background. So misinformation. In our panel, when we're talking about misinformation, we mean the incorrect or misleading information inadvertently sent to influence public opinion or obscure truth. When we're talking about disinformation, we're talking about false information that's deliberate, sometimes covertly spread in order to influence public opinion or obscure the truth. When we're talking about propaganda, we're talking about a technique in which emotion is the central method of communication. Propaganda can go both ways, negative or positive, but we're talking about a communication technique in which emotion is front and center. Our panelists today, we're going to look at the infodemic from four different perspectives: a historical perspective, a medical perspective, an information warfare perspective, and a social media perspective. As Joe mentioned, we are fortunate to have some excellent panelists with us to provide some insight into looking at this infodemic. And I'm going to do a quick introduction for each of them, and then we're just going to go ahead and begin with questions. Our first panelist, Professor Rowland Brucken, earned his PhD and MA from Ohio State University. He joined the faculty at Norwich University in 2001, and he currently serves as Associate Dean of the College of Liberal Arts. His main areas of expertise cover American diplomacy, 20th century American history, world history, and he specializes in international human rights law and U.S. civil rights. His academic research focuses on three primary areas: the origins of international human rights law during World War II, how societies can recover from mass atrocities such as genocide, crimes against humanity, and war crimes, and the history of baseball. Rowley, we're glad to have you. Thanks for joining us today. Next panelist is one of our own, Norwich alum, Mike Wilhelm. He's a nurse and dentist at the University of Connecticut Health John Dempsey Hospital in Farmington, Connecticut. He graduated from Norwich University in 1998 with a BS in electrical engineering, and he later became a registered nurse with a BS in nursing from New York University in 2008. He completed his studies in nurse anesthesia in 2010 from Central Connecticut University and received his doctorate in nursing practice from Quinnipiac University in 2018. He received the Connecticut Nightingale Award for Nursing Excellence in 2019 for his efforts in developing and utilizing opioid-free anesthesia during our opioid crisis. He's an active member of the Norwich University Board of Fellows since 2017, and he's the leader of the Connecticut Norwich Club. During this pandemic, he has been on the front lines as a vital part of this hospital team in treating and evaluating patients that have been stricken by the disease. Mike, thanks for joining us today as well. Thank you very much. Our next panelist is another one of our own Norwich alum, Pierce Reid. He's a retired business executive and police officer. He's a 2014 graduate of the Norwich University's graduate program with a master's degree in military history. During his career, he's been involved in developing information warfare doctrine, including working with the Office of ASD SOLIC in 2003 through 2005. From 1999 to 2004, he was a regular speaker at Norwich University's Info Ops Symposium, where he served as the MC several times. His article, Waging Public Relations, a Cornerstone of Fourth Generation Warfare, is published in the Journal of Information Warfare and has later been reprinted in several books as it relates to propaganda. He also publishes on military, technology, and automotive history, and he's a regular speaker on these topics. He's especially his hands-on history, which includes restoration and conservation of historical vehicles, arms, and artillery. He's participated in several conflict archaeology projects in France and Jordan, and he's a regular speaker at Norwich. He's currently the chairman of the Associates of Norwich Military Writer Symposium. Pierce, thanks for joining us today as well. Glad to have you. And the fourth panelist, Zachary Jenkins. He's from Monroe, Michigan. He's currently a student at Norwich University. He's going to be a senior next year. He's heavily involved in all things Norwich. Some of the activities that he does, he's the current editor in chief for the Norwich University Guidon, the president of the Maroon and Gold Key Club, the battalion commander for Norwich, for a battalion in the Corps of Cadets. He serves as a class senator for the Student Government Association. He's a member of the University Honors Committee, and he's a fellow for the Peace and War Center. He has a contract with the United States Army, and after graduating in May 2021, he intends to serve as an Army Intelligence or Signal Corps officer. Zach, great to see you. Thanks for joining us as well. So since the Director General's speech, the COVID-19 pandemic has resulted in conspiracy theories and misinformation about the scale of the pandemic, the origin, its prevention, its diagnosis, the treatment of the disease. False information, including disinformation, has been spread through social media, text messages, mass media, tabloids, conservative media, state media of countries such as China, Russia, and Iran. It's also been spread by state-backed covert operations to generate panic and sow distrust in other countries. Misinformation has been propagated by celebrities, politicians in multiple countries and other prominent figures. Commercial scams have taken place, from home tests to supposed preventatives to miracle cures, etc. Politicians and leaders of some of these countries have promoted cures, while some religious groups and others have purported faith healers. Others have claimed that the virus is lab-developed bioweapon, that it's accidentally leaked, and the list goes on and on to include spy operations and linking the COVID-19 pandemic to 5G networks. This is only just the beginning and a cursory overview. So, Pierce, we're going to go just directly to you. We've been talking about misinformation, disinformation. How would you define information warfare and what's its central objective?
One second here.
You're good.
Okay, you can hear me?
Good.
Okay. So information warfare or information operations is a rather big tent term. At a military level, you have some fairly proven definitions. It's using information, intelligence, psychology, camouflage and deception, kinetic operations, involving propaganda, network attack and defense, electronic warfare. There's a whole series of components that make up true information warfare. There are, as I mentioned, various components to it. One of the things, though, that I'd like to point out in the elements of an information operation or information warfare is that you have a fairly coordinated or centralized program that's going on, whether this is from a state actor or a military, which would be very typical in the U.S. The core of this has often been through Fourth Psychological Operations out of Fort Bragg, FORPOG, as the military side of things, and there are various other ways of disseminating official information and so forth. Whether you call that information warfare, whether you call that government communications, can often depend on your point of view. Ultimately, what you're trying to do at a military level, you're looking to attack an enemy's ability to communicate. You may be looking to attack their economy, their willingness to fight, or their willingness to carry on. You may be looking to create regime change or foment revolution. There's a number of reasons that you can or would do these sorts of things. At a military level, it's often used or regarded as a way to reduce casualties or actually avoid a fight. If you can get your enemy to surrender before things go hot or before the battle, that is a win in an information operations campaign. Now, Travis has asked me to tap dance through this particular minefield by answering the question or analyzing whether I think we are actually in an information war and why or why not. And it's an incredibly difficult question. One is because we are so bombarded with information right now, and this is an historical precedent where we have so much access to so much material. But we also don't know what is accurate and what is not. So without being inside or part of the clearance, the high-level clearance club, it's very hard to say what is going on at a state level, what's going on at an individual level, and so forth. My instinct is to say that this is not an information war in and of itself, because there is no specific single state actor, there is no specific individual behind it that we know of, other than the conspiracy theories. That said, it carries so many elements of information warfare. All the good stuff is sort of in there. As Travis mentioned, we're seeing propaganda, we're seeing disinformation, we're seeing things that come through the press. Examples at the state actor level have been the back and forth with China, where they've accused the U.S. of delivering the virus to their biowarfare center. Again, it's an interesting time we're in. And I'd wrap up, but Travis also asked me to mention specific media examples. Honestly, there are too many. what we really see is a battle of ideologies. This has been picked up by the media as much as by anybody. And so you can pick your flavor of what information you want to get almost based on the news source that you're looking at. I'm going to reference a terrific speaker we had at the last Colby, which is Peter W. Singer, whose book Like Wars, The Weaponization of Social Media, has really set the stage for some of this. And one of the things we really didn't get to discuss is what social media and the access to massive amounts of information have created is the ability for people to synthesize their own realities based on so many disparate facts that you can string together. You might call it a conspiracy, you might call it an alternate history, you might even call it an alternate reality. And we've really never been in that kind of world position or position in the world where not only do we have access to so much information, but we have the ability to actually look relevant or look capable of disseminating it. I said probably 30 years ago, as we were getting involved in the internet, that one of the interesting facets of it was going to let everybody be William Randolph Hearst. And I think in a large measure, that's where we are. Are we in an information war? I will say that that's to be determined. There's going to be 20 to 30 years of PhD theses and master's theses on these these events, and it remains to be seen. Travis?
Hey, thanks, Pierce. All right, so my next question is going to be going to Mike. And obviously, you've had some firsthand experience with the impact of conspiracy theories and misinformation, all of that in your line of work. So since you've witnessed this firsthand, can you just give us your insight about some of your experiences and how the wrong kind and type of COVID-19 information has directly impacted the medical field?
So one of the things that I've always found interesting with this whole thing that's been going on is that I felt that this has actually been a disease process that's the first one that's politicized. So a lot of people are basing their facts not so much on medical literature that's out there, but based on what party they per se decide they want to support. So whether they want to support Trump or they want to go against Trump, that seems to be the two things that I've always hear out there. And I've actually had some context where I've had some people that were posting stuff on Facebook just purely based on their political affiliations and what they wanted to hear. So it was kind of interesting. I made sure I printed out some so I could refer to them. So there was a whole thing where I had a person that was on social media, and he was discussing how hydroxychloroquine was not working. We can't be using it. The American Medical Association is saying not to use it. And it was interesting because the minute Trump had supported it, you know, that's when I noticed the big divide among everybody. And it was funny because the article from the American Medical Association was actually a notice recommending to slow down the prescribing of it. What basically happened was we had found that there was literature that showed that it worked, and everybody was asking their friends or doctors to prescribe it for them. And it was being prescribed so frequently that it almost shut down the market in the United States, and you weren't even able to get it. So I know here in the state of Connecticut, you couldn't even get it for like a week. So that was kind of interesting. The other thing too is people just continuously post things or want to share information that's, they just share the title. They don't actually look at the literature that they're actually posting. So, you know, they go off their thing about, you know, one of them that I have here was small trial hydroxychloroquine is not effective for treating coronavirus, which is an article that was in France, which I'm sure I think a lot of people have seen. And it was interesting because if you looked at the actual article, they actually stated in there, you know, it's kind of interesting. This actually worked. And we suggest that more gets done on this. We just couldn't prove a statistical significance. And which is what typically happens in studies that are done in a short time frame or don't have enough participants in it. So that was always an interesting one. Other people have posted one about one that was causing heart problems in the patients, which turned out to be in Brazil. And if you read the article again, 200 milligrams is the standard dose of hydroxychloroquine that we would give. They were giving 800 to 1,000 milligrams a day. So which hydroxychloroquine is can cause lethal heart arrhythmias. So that was one of the things that I thought was kind of interesting. But this politicizing of this disease is what's making things dangerous, because people are believing what they want to believe just based on who they want to support. So I actually have some people that I know that would not, they would actually go to the hospital, not take this medication, which we're not 100% sure if it's really effective. It's been helping in some avenues, but they would not take it just because they want to prove that the president is wrong. So it's kind of an interesting concept that goes on with this. And this goes on to even outside of COVID-19, it's the same thing with everything else. You know, when you go into anti-vax movement or anything else, the same thing. People are going through what they believe despite what the medical literature is. And, you know, just like Pierce was just saying before, you know, information is so freely available nowadays. It's a click of a button, you're sharing wrong information, and people are only reading a title and not going into it further. That makes this dangerous. So
your comment about making this this pandemic politicized, that's that further increases the impact of disinformation or misinformation, because it's aligned with a particular perspective, then it's only magnified, and people will continue to find sources that reinforce the way in which they're thinking about a particular solution. So on the back end, how have you seen the medical field respond to erroneous or potentially dangerous information? So in other words, counter messaging from the medical field, what have you seen?
So within the hospital system and everything, it's been great. I mean, the biggest thing with misinformation or disinformation that we had a problem with was the sharing of information from China. So we saw how later on, and I'm sure most people have seen this in the news, how the numbers were totally different later on. So here we thought we had something that was kind of controlled and controllable, and then it turned out to be a little bit worse than we thought. But we were pretty lucky in the United States. I really do not think we got hit as bad as most people think we did. Our system in Connecticut, at least in the state of Connecticut, we didn't get that overwhelmed. New York definitely had its problems, but the problem that you had too was people would put out information about what was going on, and everybody wanted to get tested for this, and people not realizing we have a limited amount of tests. If you don't have symptoms, we can't test you, because then we're just wasting a test, you know, and that was the big problem that was going on with this as well. The other thing too that I wanted to mention too is that, you know, people were putting out information about these self-made cures, which I believe you talked about in your intro. You know, I actually had a friend of mine the other day posted about, make sure you have oranges and orange juice and drink some lemons, and it increases your body pH. And me being a healthcare professional, what I do is I always say, listen, man, that's not going to work, you know? And, you know, people have to realize it's a much more complex system to get your body's acid, alkalinity balanced than just eating lemons, you know? But otherwise, within the hospital system, everyone's been good. We've always focused on the medical literature that's out there, and we purely based our opinions on that. So when people were telling me hydroxychloroquine is not going to work because the president wants it, I said, we've been using it for a month before. So, you know, I don't know what you're talking about. And that was pretty much where I stand by with the medical stuff.
Okay, thanks. And, you know, for all of you that are joining us today, today's panel is just meant to be a cursory survey of topics that we could devote additional panels and legacy of learning too. So thanks for your insight, Mike. So the next question, I'm going to transition to you, Rolly. And throughout the media at the very beginning, there was a discussion about how we're in unprecedented times, uncharted waters, that we've never been here before. And then a week and a half or 2 weeks later, we begin to hear that, wait, that's not the case. There is some sort of precedent. It took back in 1918 with the Spanish flu. So there's been a lot of that in the news, but just for the sake of today's panel, could you just give us a concise sketch just of some of the details for the 1918 Spanish flu?
Sure. Thanks, Travis. The Spanish flu, or H1N1, is probably the greatest pandemic in world history, with the possible exception of the bubonic plague, and we don't, of course, have a lot of good data, macro data on the bubonic plague. Spanish flu, about a third of the world was infected, perhaps up to 500 million people got the virus that caused the, quote, Spanish flu. Out of that, between 50 and 100 million people died. And of course, 50 to 100 million is a huge gap. Again, it gets to the lack of data collection even in 1918. Whole continents, we have inaccurate data or very scarce data. So a lot of this is estimates. that 50 to 100 million dead, we can compare to 10 million who died in World War I, roughly the same time period. In the United States, we had 675,000 deaths or so. About 25% of the American population was infected. The case mortality rate was about 2.5% or slightly less. The Spanish flu was an avian flu. It originated in birds. We don't know where it began. Even today, it might have begun in China. It might have begun in Kansas. It's called the Spanish flu because Spain's newspapers during World War I were not censored because Spain was a neutral country. And so the first cases came out of Spain because the government willingly acknowledged that the Spanish flu was spreading very quickly there. Just like with COVID, there was no vaccine, and so treatment was largely non-pharmacological. And this will sound very familiar to us today. Treatment in 1918 for the Spanish flu was isolation and quarantine, hand washing, and wearing cloth masks. So that's sort of a general background. The final thing I want to mention, just in terms of the relevance for today, three main waves of the Spanish flu. The first started in roughly March of 1918, although again, it was spread before that. The second wave, after folks got tired of quarantining and isolating, was in the fall of 1918, also when troops arrived home from Europe at the end of World War I. And then there was a third wave in early 1919, the second wave, though, being by far the deadliest.
Okay. And I know that's very difficult to put all that in a couple of minutes, so thanks, Rowley, for doing that for us. And as I mentioned, some of the comparisons in the news have focused on some of the data that you are highlighting about the actual virus and the physical outcomes. And today's panel just takes a different take, if you will. And we are interested in comparing how the informational domains compare between 1918 and 2020. So can you outline how the infodemic of 1918 compares to the one in 2020?
Yeah, so several trends are very striking. One is that national governments have an interest in downplaying the impact of the virus on their own citizens. During World War I, that was very clear. Because of World War I, nations did not want to acknowledge their own internal weaknesses, nor depress the morale of their own soldiers. And so, for example, the U.S. Surgeon General, Rupert Blue, said that, quote, there was no cause for alarm. When the outbreak began to be reported in 1918 by local newspapers, Woodrow Wilson was completely silent, President Wilson, on the pandemic. And so it fell to state and local governments to act or not act. Most famously, for example, in Philadelphia, the city's health commissioner was a gynecologist and political appointee who simply did nothing to prevent the spread in Philadelphia. And as a result, there was a very high death rate. A second is that there's a lot of misinformation about the causes. So one thing that's very clear is that if accurate information is not out there, inaccurate information will take up that space. And so there were conspiracy theories back in 1918. The virus was spread by German submarines. The virus was spread by Jews, anti-Semitism being very high in Europe and in the United States. The virus was God's punishment for dancing and early forms of jazz music among very conservative Christians. It was spread by volcanic activity or a misalignment of the planets or Russian oats imported into the United States. So a lot of misinformation and conspiracy theories about the cause. Secondly, doctors also provided inaccurate information, not deliberately, but because they didn't understand either. And so their patients needed information. And so they gave advice like eating cinnamon, drinking wine or beef broth, taking up to 30 grams of aspirin. Which today only 4 grams is recommended. The tragedy of aspirin poisoning is that it led to some of the same effects that the Spanish flu itself did, internal bleeding, for example, and fluid in the lungs. So you might have died from Spanish flu or from doctor's advice to take 30 grams or more of aspirin a day. And finally, there were all sorts of self-interested parties that put out information. Massage parlors said, what better way to get over the Spanish flu, then go to a massage parlor and have a massage by us. That'll make you feel better. Or cooking 12 onions and drinking the juice from those 12 onions. The onion industry promoting a cure in ads and newspapers. So misinformation goes viral, pun intended, in 1918, just as much as it does as today. The main vehicles being word of mouth and newspapers that were full of advertisements that were completely government unregulated. And so we're free to make substantial claims and or unsubstantiated claims. And so misinformation spread very quickly, and people wanted to believe that they were safe and secure and in control of their own health. So many believed in this misinformation.
So you stated quite a few interesting facts and data, and one of them being when misinformation or disinformation transcends from just being an idea or something printed, and it starts to influence people. In other words, it moves from the idea to something concrete. And the examples that you've listed also repeat what's happening in 2020. Several people doing exactly the same. And so I think for those that are going through this pandemic, the precedent, it's not only just the virus itself, but some of the critical connections as it relates to information are parallel. And that's appreciate your insight in that area. So Zach, let's transition to you, and we're going to look at social media. So thank you, Rowling. We're going to look at social media and how we've used the term going viral before the pandemic, but now it takes on quite a different spin. And we know that the role of social media to your generation is incredibly significant. And you being on the panel, you provide some insight on how COVID-19's backlash, how it's impacted university students as well as Norwich students. So I'd like you first just to provide some context for us as it relates to social media. If you could just outline, what are some of the most popular social media platforms for university students? And if you can outline some of those and then tell us why, and then what would be, let's say, an average number of texts receives a day from 18 to 25 year olds? And if you could just address those two questions.
Yeah, so thank you so much. So some of the biggest things to keep in mind when you're looking at our generation specifically is the fact that we have grown up in the digital age. And so, you know, myself and my peers, that's all we've known through our entire lives. You know, we didn't see the transition from newspaper to online media. You know, it's always been online for us. And so when you look at some of the mainstream social media platforms such as Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, Twitter, TikTok, which most notably has been banned by a lot of government and military organizations because of its roots in China, you have to think, you know, how are people really receiving their news? And for the people who have grown up with these, who have known them through their entire lives, it's kind of like a mainstream source for them. And so you look at Facebook, as of 2018, according to Pew Research, Facebook was the number one news media outlet for millennials. And we'll talk a little bit more about why that's an issue moving forward. And then you asked about the average number of texts per day. That's sitting, as of 2018, that was sitting at 128, and it's actually only continued to go up from year to year. I'm not sure about the number of tweets. Personally, I don't use Twitter. But I know I do have some friends and friends of friends who will tweet 3 to 5 times per day, and they basically outline their entire days on the internet. And so you can kind of see how that's an issue when it comes to security, and then of course when it comes to how involved they are with what they actually read on the internet and how much they follow that. Does that answer your question? So,
yeah, it does. Thank you. And you mentioned a little bit about news, but where and how do your peers receive news? What would you say?
Yeah, so again, going back to Facebook, I can definitely agree with that. So at the beginning of the pandemic, you know, in around the March timeframe, I was on Facebook myself, and you couldn't go more than two different posts without seeing something that contradicted itself. So finally, for me, I basically just shut it off. You know, I don't even pay attention to Facebook anymore. What I do personally is I go straight to the Associated Press, and I just read the raw articles that they publish on the Associated Press, and that's how I get my news. But if you go on Facebook today and you look at people part of the 18 to 24 year old age bracket, you'll see again, and this is something that Michael mentioned, a lot of people who will share headlines rather than actually sharing articles. So they'll see something that appeals to their point of view and what they want to be true. And they'll go ahead and share that because they want to try and push whatever their point of view is. And so this actually creates a number of unique problems. Like, for example, putting credible news sources in danger. With the amount of different perspectives out there, you look at like the New York Times, you look at Fox News, CNN, stuff like that. A lot of people don't really trust them anymore because they don't know what to trust because they're so bombarded with information. So the entire online environment now has been subject to information saturation. And it's really creating an anxiety society because nobody knows exactly what to trust, where to get their news from, or what to think, because this information saturation has eliminated the ability for people to think for themselves and to actually come to a conclusion based on the journalism that they're reading, which for those of you who have studied journalism, you know that that's the fundamental purpose of it. You present raw facts and then you give people the ability to think for themselves and come to a conclusion based on what they read. It's all based on the individual reader's interpretation. And lately, facts have been muffled by opinions, which have just been basically trying to push agendas. And so you can see that with all this online social media platforms. You look at, for example, the 2020 election, which is coming up here in November. As of a year ago, there were 86 million fake news hits on Facebook surrounding that election. And that's a year ago. You can only imagine, I don't think there's any statistics on that yet. That comes from Avaz Foundation. I don't think there's any statistics yet on the sheer number of fake news hits as related to coronavirus, just because it's spreading so rapidly and it's so hard to contain and so hard to actually conceive of just the sheer amount and by country and globally. But yeah, fake news, it's going to continue to be one of the biggest issues that we face. And it's putting a lot of things in peril. I don't know if you guys have seen Plandemic, which is something that's been moved around Facebook quite a bit. A lot of people have shared that simply because the techniques, the recording techniques that they used for it seemed professional, and they seemed professional enough that people would take it as legit. When in reality, you can actually find a debunk video of a doctor, an actual doctor, going through every single fact that they claimed on that video and debunking every single one of them because they're simply not true. And so, you know, it's just stuff like that. And it's really what it really roots to, again, is people don't know where they get their news and they don't know what to trust and they don't know how to evaluate news as real or fake. And so that's really what we're facing. And as a generation, it's important to keep in mind where we came from in order to influence where we're going.
Excellent, Zac. So I'm going to ask the rest of the panel to rejoin us. And I have one final question for the panel. And then, Stephanie, we're going to take questions if we have any from the audience. So my question to the panel, we've just scratched the surface on some of the information surrounding COVID-19 and how it continues to evolve. What advice would you give or practical recommendations would you solicit for media consumers and to navigate through facts, emotion, disinformation, also propaganda and news stories? What advice would you give, Rowley?
Yeah, as a researcher, I think the general public fundamentally misunderstands the process of research and expects research to be readily available, always accurate, and never to be revised. And certainly Michael can talk about this in terms of the medical profession, but scientists work always with never enough information, just like all researchers do. And the process of finding and verifying information takes time and requires patience, which is exactly understandably what many of us don't have or don't want to have during a pandemic. So understanding that our knowledge is evolving, to use, as Zac mentioned, sources that are trusted, and know that we'll get better information that might contradict or partially contradict existing knowledge. And that's okay, that's how we get better.
Thanks, Rowley. Anybody else? Yeah, Mike.
Well, you know, Professor Rowley, exactly like you said, I mean, the general public does not understand medical literature at all and how research is done. We were talking about it at work the other day. We were talking about how in order to make this really work, you need a nice random controlled trial or a double blind, double study which is basically where nobody knows, you know, you're giving someone a pill, they're not sure what they're getting. They find out later on because it's all written down in a journal. Well, you got the sugar pill, you know, we'll see who's doing better. And in a pandemic, it's not the time to figure that out, because who wants to really know, well, I would have made it, but they gave me the sugar pill, you know, it's just not ethical to do. Same reason why no medication will ever really be deemed safe for a pregnancy, because we can't give a medication to a pregnant woman that's pregnant in case there is damage done to the fetus. So that's definitely the biggest problem, is that the American public, even the world, they want their information. They want it now. They want the cure now. We're such an instantaneous society that nobody's willing to go through and say, medical people need to take their time. They need to evaluate what's going on, take things slowly. We're going to try this medication. Now we're going to try this one. But everybody wants a sure thing. And that's one of the biggest problems in society that moves away from medical, but that's our biggest battle that we have.
Okay. Thank you. Zach.
Yeah, so just jumping right on to what Rowley and Michael were talking about. So when it comes to this kind of stuff, I think one of the best things that you can do specifically if you're on social media is really detach yourself from what you read online. And if you're going to go ahead and believe a certain article that you read on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram, whatever it may be, go ahead and fact check that yourself. And also make sure that you're screening it yourself for any type of bias that might be present with whatever media it is that you're consuming. Because like Michael was saying, people really don't understand the medical process. You're going to see a lot of people sharing headlines. You know, like I mentioned earlier, a great example of this is a few weeks ago, I actually got shared a link by one of my friends, and it was just a headline. And it said, Norwich University cancels the fall semester. And, you know, at first my gut reaction was, oh my God, you know, this is terrible. But then I clicked on it and it said, you've been tricked. You know, so it's really easy to get to people's heartstrings by just showing headlines. The biggest thing that you can do is make sure that you're checking their facts and making sure that you're not sharing those headlines and not taking things at their face value.
So you just mentioned, Zach, a critical feature, and that is being an unwilling participant in spreading misinformation by sending headlines, by sending stories and unverified information to all of your friends and links and connections, et cetera. And this is how something can go from one story with 10 readers to well over a million in 24 hours. And there's a reason it is called it going viral. And so Pierce, anything to add?
I think the biggest thing I can add is that we have very high ideals here about people being cautious consumers, about, you know, checking the footnotes to use the historical reference to make sure the research is good, to use the scientific method and understand the difference between a conjecture, a hypothesis, and a theory, and all of these things. But we also see a lot of people who are highly willing consumers of any kind of disinformation or spreaders of it because it fits their own narrative. And there's a lot of people who are out there actually searching for things that fit a construct that they've built for themselves, whether it's political, whether it's ideological, whether it's nationalist, whether it's racial, whatever it is, and then they are building the facts that they find around it to create their own reality. And so this sort of thing is going to continue and probably get worse. COVID-19, we could argue, is not the disease, it's the symptom, and what is happening with the global panic, the global disinformation, and the secondary, tertiary events are really what are the scary results. And I was flailing around being the historian for an event that maybe most fit what we're seeing right now. And Professor Brucken Rowley did a fantastic job on the 1918 pandemic. But I looked at it through the information warfare lens, and the closest thing that I really saw were the McCarthy hearings of the 1950s. And the reason for that was we had an ideological fight going on. We had two sides. We actually had multiple sides. We had television for one of the first times in history covering every moment of them. The newspaper people were watching it. Hollywood was involved. All the editorials were about it. And it was a highly divisive event that ultimately it didn't matter whether there were communists in the State Department or not. It was a polarizing thing globally. 70 years later, it still has an effect on our culture. We're still debating it. We're still learning about it. And there's still divisions coming off it. And this is where I look at the next 10, 20 years of people researching this and really finding out what happened, not medically with a virus, which will pass, but socially and sociologically.
Okay. Thanks, Pierce. Stephanie, do we have any questions from attendees?
We do. I thought I would just show myself so I'm not the voice of God, but I'll read some questions, and then if you guys want to just roundtable it and you know respond, that would be great. So there's quite a few, so let's see if we can get through them.
Just kick it off.
Okay. The first one is from Walt Gunning, and he is asking, how could the free press better handle disinformation? So I don't know which one of you wants to take that. Go ahead, Zach.
I'll jump in and start, which is to use the basic precepts of reporting, which is report the facts and not necessarily a point of view or an editorial. There are great places for editorials, but there are places for researched news. And one of the things that you don't see today, the myth of the reporter in the fedora hat with the notebook heading out to find a story is long gone, if it ever did exist. Reporters wait for press releases, they wait for pitch phone calls, they wait for the stories essentially to be handed to them, and then they can synthesize whatever looks like the most interesting, relevant, timely, or to be cynical, the news that will sell the most papers, the old if it bleeds, it leads headline. So you didn't learn in journalism school that you were, as a reporter, that you were supposed to be a propaganda arm or a mouthpiece. Be reporters. Do the things that you were trained to do.
Zach, thanks, Pierce. You had a comment, Zach.
Yeah, so basically just exactly what Pierce said. So I know my own experience with this is a little bit limited just because of the amount of exposure I've had to journalism in my lifetime. But you look at, you know, for the little experience that I have had, you look at journalism and you look at the time that they actually turn it around. And oftentimes, going right back to what Pierce said, they're just publishing what has been handed to them. They're not actually doing any digging themselves. And so that can create a lot of problems because they're on deadlines that are so short that they're actually not able to get an accurate story out to the public because they're only using secondhand information or third-hand information, and they're not actually looking at it from a journalistic point of view. They're just looking at it from, oh, I got to get this out because we have a limited amount of time. So with that, there's going to be so many different areas for errors to occur. And so really, I think just slowing down a little bit in spots could really help to fix a lot of those issues.
Okay, Stephanie, back to you. Thank you. Thanks, Zach.
We have another question from Bree Hoblin. Bree is asking, are there any insights from the way the Spanish flu was finally brought under control that shed light on our current situation with COVID-19, either in terms of the infodemic or the pandemic itself?
Rowland.
Oh, he needs to be unmuted. Here we go.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Rowland.
Yeah, that's a great question because the H1N1 virus essentially ran itself out. The herd immunity developed, and there was never any vaccination covered. Those who acquired it and who did not have hospital care, largely, this gets to why the death toll was so uncertain, died in their homes. Those who were most vulnerable in terms of race and ethnicity, died in their homes unreported. So it in essence ran through the world's population, and then by 1921 was no longer a public health emergency. That's certainly what some have been advocating, reopening the country and developing herd immunity through that, just simply exposure, and then the virus would then not be the death rate would fall because herd immunity would develop. I'll leave that to Michael to comment about the wisdom of that strategy, but that's essentially what happened in 1918. So I don't think there's a whole lot of relevance from how that ended with what the emergency we have today.
You know, it's interesting because when we look at the way that these viruses always work, and, you know, it goes back to the same thing again about misinformation. I mean, there was a big article that went out not too long ago that said, we're not sure if you would develop antibodies from this if you're actually immune from it. Kind of like the flu, but even worse. You know, the flu, you get the flu shot, you're good for a year, you get a downgraded flu. So the big fear was that if you got this, were you going to get it again? You know, personally, the people that I've seen that have been sick with this have been really sick people to begin with. It's not like people like Zach that are coming in and getting put on a ventilator and dying from this disease. Ironically, I mean, it does happen. And, you know, there was a nice article that went out not too long about a UK football player that died from COVID-19. And then, oh, 21-year-old football player died. And then if you read the article, because, you know, no one ever goes past the title lately. And, oh, he had undiagnosed leukemia. And that's what wound up getting, you know, he died from COVID-19 symptoms because of that. So, I mean, I think the thing is, it comes down to I think our country's not sure what we want to do. Do we want to stay in-house for a little bit? I mean, we do have the technology that we didn't have in 1918 where people can do work from home and stuff like that, and maybe wait a little bit. But yet, you know, people do want to start working. You know, unemployment only pays so much of what people need to spend, you know, for the money that they have budgeted for themselves. So it's kind of interesting. Here in Connecticut, I think we're going to be starting opening up a couple of small things, I think next week, and we're going to see where it goes. We're preparing from the medical end for another influx if it happens. So we'll have to see what happens.
And time will tell, right? And we also have Michigan that's represented too. That's where Zach's calling us from. Stefan, let's take one more question, and that'll wrap up our time for today. What do you have for us?
I have one more from Anthony Purdy. It says, understanding that a lot of intelligence associated with information warfare is highly classified, how can the DOD or the intelligence communities better help private companies like Twitter and Facebook, et cetera, identify and corral false information narratives and propaganda? Pierce, probably.
Yeah, Pierce.
Everybody's looking at me.
I can comment on that, too.
A very difficult question. First of all, because of the massive amount of information that's out there, and one person's fake news is another person's real news. Whether the narrative or whatever adds up, it's very difficult to decide whether you're going to be the censor or not. And it's one of the challenges social media platforms have right now. And it's one of the things that I think is going to be whether it's legislative or whether it's a market-driven thing, is what is allowed with censorship? What is allowed as far as a private platform? I was a senior communications person at CompuServe in the early days of the internet. We had a court case called Cubby v. CompuServe, which essentially kept us from doing any kind of censorship or moderating. That's really changed. Now, there's public policy decisions right now that have to be looked at with companies like Twitter, Facebook, Google, the big ones that are virtual monopolies. They are virtual public utilities. Zach probably doesn't pick up the phone much and use Ma Bell, which was the monopoly back in the day, but is 100% dependent on messaging through social media, Google and Twitter and other accounts in order to communicate. So where do these become publicly regulated monopolies? Where do these companies have to go hands off and allow any communication to occur across them? Now, the question of intelligence agencies and helping with censoring and things, it's really not going to happen. They're so firewalled, and they really should be. There shouldn't be intelligence agencies or law enforcement agencies or other government agencies guiding social media unless they become monopoly or regulated monopolies. But it's a big question, and it's going to be something that I think is some fallout from COVID.
So that's a billion-dollar question, because the companies that can solve that will be operating in the billions of dollars of revenue to solve that equation. So, and thus, you know, Pierce was outlining some of the complexities with freedom of speech, and then the ability to disseminate that, and also, what is a fact? And someone's fact, as Pierce was saying, is someone else's perspective, and stats can also be debated. I think the question that we can maybe discuss at another panel is, when does disinformation or misinformation crosses over into the kinetic world and concrete and really cause harm? So, for example, bullying and cyberbullying. When does fake news or misinformation or disinformation become criminalized? Singapore's done it. Other countries are looking into do it, because they realize that it doesn't just have an ideological or a cognitive impact. It can cause real harm. But we'll save that and that discussion for another panel. We're about out of time. And I know that there's quite a few questions. We can address those questions later on, and Stephanie can help us follow up with those. But would like to, first of all, thank the Alumni Office and Stephanie for all your great work and setting this up and making it happen. So applause to you. Our panelists, Zach, Rowley, Mike, and Pierce, thank you for your time and preparation and shedding some light on a topic that we could spend discussing every single week over the summer. But as several of you have mentioned, it's only going to continue to increase in significance. And the pandemic in a lot of ways has just made this more relevant for a lot of people when we're talking about misinformation and disinformation and propaganda, because people have experienced it now and they've had firsthand accounts. So to all of you that are joining us, thank you for your time, attendees. We appreciate it and appreciate your questions. And as we here say at Norwich, and I'm talking to you from Northfield, Norwich forever. Enjoy the rest of your day. Thanks for your time, everybody. All right.